So to begin, we've got Peter Schuck, who is a Simon Baldwin professor at Yale. He's a well-known tort scholar. He's also an administrative law scholar, which of course is a great combo for this particular panel, and he's visiting at NYU this semester as well. So what more can we say, Peter?
Thank you, and thank you, Guido, for a wonderful keynote. I'm used to listening to Guido in faculty meetings, 9 years of faculty meetings, and that was usually pleasurable, but it's more when he's talking about ideas. Now, we have very little time here, so let me get down to cases quickly. Let me begin with three premises, and then I want to talk about the implications of those premises. The first is that all regulatory agencies are flawed, even the best of them, like the Fed. So if you read the New York Times front page article today, you'll see that that particular theme being explored with respect to the Fed. Now, some of these flaws of agencies are structural and political. Many, I think the most important, however, have to do with uncertainty, the uncertainty that adheres in the complexity of the activity that they are regulating. And most of those have to do with lack of information, lack of good predictive information. These are exacerbated by the bureaucratic incentives that agency officials exhibit, often mediocre talent in agencies, and sometimes, though I think this is much less important than some others do, excessive industry influence over decisions. Second premise is that FDA suffers from all of these shortcomings, but it is the best in the world at doing what it does, and it's well to keep that in mind. I'm talking mainly today about FDA, although many of my observations will apply much more broadly. Most of the shortcomings that the FDA exhibits can be improved. The 2007 amendments that Congress enacted promise to go a good distance toward that. And you may, if you've read the, as I'm sure you all have, the Obama budget in great detail, you'll find a huge budget increase for the FDA in 2009, in 2010. In addition, the FDA suffers from, but also benefits from, immense oversight, very intensive oversight, fierce oversight by congressional committees, the GAO, interest groups, whistleblowers, media, specialized and general media, professional associations. But John Dingell and now Henry Waxman are very, very vigilant auditors of what FDA does. Third premise and last premise is that, in contrast, the shortcomings of courts and juries and expert testimony in cases that involve intricate techno-scientific judgments, which are the kinds of judgments we're talking about today, I want to emphasize that. We're not speaking more generally, at least I'm not, about the capacity of agencies and juries. We're talking about a specific kind of case. Those shortcomings cannot be reduced. They are inherent in the nature of these institutions, and no amount of money, additional authority, or talent can alter those shortcomings of juries and courts and expert testimony. Now, what are those shortcomings relative to agencies and in this kind of case? So it's a comparative, an explicitly comparative analysis that I'm going to summarize. And in this kind of case, that is to say, a highly technocratic case. Well, the first shortcoming of courts and juries have to do with a technocratic capacity to adduce and to analyze facts about the empirical trade-offs that are at the center of these sorts of regulatory decisions. Jurors, for all the wonderful characteristics that they bring to the courtroom, are pre-selected for their ignorance about anything but common sense and common values. And I would argue that this common sense and common values were extraordinarily valuable in many, many areas in which jurors make decisions, are a very poor guide to understanding and assessing the trade-offs in highly technocratic decisions. These trade-offs are not just costs and benefits, they are also trade-offs between risk on the one hand and risk on the other. There are federalism dimensions in which jurors have absolutely no special insight, or perhaps no insight at all, having to do with the, as Judge Calabresi suggested, value of uniform standards on the one hand versus state-by-state variation on the other. Jurors have absolutely no insight into that. A fourth shortcoming in their technocratic capacity has to do with knowledge about how the juror's decision will affect a number of absolutely critical components of a technocratic system. The degree of uncertainty, industry innovation and investment, the regulatory environment, the availability of insurance, and countless other variables that jurors know nothing about and couldn't possibly learn about, and there's nothing in the trial tort litigation process itself that would educate them about this. A second kind of shortcoming is the comprehensiveness of view of relevant facts and values that one wants to bring to technocratic decisions. Courts and jurors focus on a single case, obsessively on a single case and a single set of parties. We know a priori, because of a lot of legal research done by my colleague George Priest and others, that these cases are atypical. They are not representative of the reality out there in the world of disputes and of regulation. They're atypical, otherwise they would not be in court. The jury sees only a single putative victim, not the countless putative beneficiaries of a regulatory decision. So as the court said quite properly in the Regal decision, the patients who reaped those benefits are not represented in court, something else that Dean Calabresi alluded to in his remarks. A third kind of categorical shortcoming has to do with accountability. The accountability of juries is zero. Not inadequate, it is zero. Everything about the jury process conspires against accountability. Its Delphic verdicts are inscrutable in the extreme. They give not a clue as to the facts that they found, the content of the legal standards that they actually applied, as distinct from what the judge instructed them to decide, or the reasoning process that linked facts and standards to their ultimate verdict. And here I come to a nice point that Kathy Sharkey has made in her work, that jury verdicts actually can detract from the agency's accountability by facilitating buck passing between the agency and the tort system. The fourth kind of categorical shortcoming that one finds in juries and courts is the capacity that perhaps this is the most important virtue of any system of risk regulation, be it by courts or by agencies, and that is the capacity to learn, corrigibility, improvement of decisions over time. Here, as we know, the common law, for very good reasons, proceeds slowly and incrementally. It's driven by opportunistic legal entrepreneurs who have concern only for their clients and for themselves, not for the overall system of risk regulation. This is a system of ad hocery, writ large. Now, I am not beating up on plaintiffs' lawyers. Quite the contrary, I want to suggest that they have a very, very important role to play in our system. Contributing to the technocratic capacity to improve decision making over time, they actually move in the other direction by reason of their focus on particular cases. Courts decide whatever disputes these entrepreneurs happen to deliver to them at any particular time, largely in the order that cases were filed. This is the very opposite of a synoptic view, of the kind of synoptic, comprehensive view that we should want to take when we're making the kinds of technocratic trade-offs that I've just mentioned. The tort system, as Judge Calabresi mentioned, as we all know, is radically decentralized among thousands of trial judges in 50 different jurisdictions, only loosely coordinated, only loosely monitored, and brought into congruence, very loosely. Indeed. Rectification of a mistake by a court or a jury is almost impossible, except in the very long run. That is to say, over decades, it may be that the common law will catch up with errors that it's made, but that will only be fortuitous and after a very long period of time. In contrast, the agency's feedback loops are relatively short and quite responsive to error. They can issue rules to rectify the mistakes that they learn about, and they are proactive in their information seeking. The last categorical shortcoming of courts may seem to be paradoxical, because it has to do with compensation. The great virtue of tort law, as it said, is to compensate victims whose rights have been invaded wrongfully. That's true. But the compensation function of the tort system is completely unsystematic. It's almost random, depending upon the kinds of fortuities of who knows about their rights, who's able to get a lawyer, how good the lawyers are, and a host of other variables that bear no relationship to what a socially rational and fair system of compensation would be compared with social insurance, for example. I mention that not because social insurance is on the table today, or is an important subject for our discussion today, but only because the compensation function is seen to be the signal paradigmatic advantage of tort law, and as I say, it could not be more unsystematic in its structure. So. I want to close with my earlier point, that these relative weaknesses of the common law cannot be fixed. They are inherent in the nature of the common law, which has many virtues. This is one of the reasons I teach torts, because I appreciate those virtues. Those shortcomings cannot be fixed. Those of agencies can be fixed, and hopefully will be fixed, particularly in the immediate years to come. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Mark Seidenfeld, who's the Patricia Doerr Professor of Administrative Law at Florida State University College of Law. He is not a tort scholar. He's an administrative law person, environmental law, and so on. So, Mark.
Thank you for the introduction. I'm learning a lot about torts as we go along. I really appreciate the chance to be here, especially following Peter, who did some of the hard work that I was hoping I wouldn't have to do in my 12 minutes or so. Let me tell you a little bit about how my paper evolved to sort of set the stage, which is I started asking the questions that Peter asked and Dean Calabresi mentioned first off, which is which institution might be more capable of making some of these technocratic, you know, balancing decisions and the like. And I went through and heard some that I didn't think of, but thought of many of the arguments that Peter made. On the other hand, I also found, and maybe Peter knows this and didn't present it, or maybe we just disagree, that there are some advantages in some cases to a tort system. I can get into it later, but let me just mention now that regulatory bodies regulate and take action at time one when the information is uncertain. Tort claims often come out after the regulatory system has acted and the product goes on the market. You have a lot more experience, a lot more information. Now, it is true that the agency could come back, but sometimes they don't have an incentive to do so because they're on to other things. And many times they do. I'm a fan of agencies as well. But one thing they often don't have is the incentive to dig out the information once they've acted in the first place. And you've got these tort lawyers out there who say, you know, I see an injury. I'm going to go and find out what the company knows. I'm going to get some experts to do some research. I'm going to develop information. So there may be some advantages to allowing a tort system because it motivates the development and publication of information that may be essential to the balance between liability versus regulation, or liability versus no liability. Secondly, this is probably more empirically questionable, but there's a sense in which at least the way things have operated, tort systems have generated public awareness of issues that regulation doesn't seem to do. You start seeing tort suits for mass torts for hundreds of millions of dollars, and it's all over the media. Now, that could have advantages and disadvantages. It has the advantages of, you know, if we want a deliberate process which is accountable to the people and the people, you know, if you're at all Republican with a little r in your notion of what government should be, well, here's an example where people actually do talk about government decisions. On the other hand, they may have very inaccurate information because the media tends to sensationalize. Certainly the plaintiff's attorneys feed into that sensationalization, so I'm not sure you get a nice, deliberate, accurate, accountable approach, but at least you get some discussion. I don't know if that's good or bad. I guess the other issue is, you know, Peter points out that the tort system is imperfect in terms of the evaluation of costs and benefits, which is true, but the producers have a lot of information, and so the question the producer you want to put on the producer is it's what Judge Calabresi said about incentivizing. If they feel that the tort system on average is going to get the liability correctly, they have an incentive to take into account the potential liabilities, and they do have more information than even the regulators and certainly the juries. So if you can somehow convince them that the tort system is close enough that they worry about it, then you might incentivize the producers to do the right thing and warn or price the product appropriately or take it off the market if it isn't justified. Although there are some offer-asking problems when you're dealing with things like lives and things like that. And as to the compensation scheme, I think I agree that it's pretty ad hoc in the tort system. But if once we decide that some people should be compensated, the alternative, it's hard to come up with a regulatory alternative that doesn't involve taxes, and it's hard to get taxes passed politically. If you want to politicize compensation, that's great. Given everything else we have on the political table, I'm not sure that's something that's really ever going to happen. So my bottom line was, when I came to this, I really am mostly a fan of agencies, and for all the reasons Peter said, I like what they do more than the jury system generally. But it really depends sometimes on the individual regulatory scheme and sometimes on the particular product as to whether or not having a tort suit and tort liability will be good or bad. Some products under the same regulatory regime, you can have products like vaccines that have huge public benefits, and the argument is even if you can't price them so that they can pay the liabilities, we still might want them. We still might want to say, look, as long as you do this and meet this standard, you will not be liable, and we'd have to come up with some other way if we want to compensate. There are other products, maybe Vioxx is a good example, where we're talking about a painkiller that does marginally better, if at all, than others that are on the market that cause significant harms, where you might say, well, you know, that's a different kind of calculation, and maybe we don't mind tort liability in that case. You know, I'm not an expert on the FDA or on these drugs. This is just my sort of remarks. So the first thing I was led to is my conclusion, which is there really is no one answer to this. It really depends on the regulatory scheme, the product, and the details of the situation. So that led me to the question I really think is worth focusing on, which is who should decide who decides who decides, which is who should decide whether preemption is appropriate or not. And I'll give you my conclusions first because I may run out of time, but my conclusion is that with the proper structuring of the administrative process, agencies generally, not always but generally, are, I think, the better able institution to evaluate whether tort suits are worth allowing or not allowing. That it's the tort judge, while he may be, or juries and things like that, may be good at some things such as, or maybe not that good, but good enough at compensation and setting on average liabilities. They're not very good at the things of, do we need uniformity? Do we need a certainty for this product to remain on the market? Is it worth having the product remain on the market? Who are the beneficiaries? What are the causal, and the beneficiaries issue can be really hard because sometimes in torts we worry about the injury, but we don't worry about the counterfactual. If it wasn't on the market, what would the person have done and what kind of injuries would you have had otherwise? My favorite example, which isn't from medicine or anything like that, is that most juries don't think about the fact that the person who buys the snowblower might save getting a heart attack when he cuts himself on the snowblower. So Anyway, there are lots of these, and for that reason, I think agencies are generally better, not perfect, but generally better, and can be made better, as Peter said, with the proper structuring of the process and oversight. Now here, on the second question, we have another actor, Congress. Interestingly, most people think that preemption decisions should be for Congress. We have this notion of federalism, and I'll let the federalism people debate that, but I'm an instrumental federalist. I'm not someone who thinks that states exist for the sake of states, you know, existing. I like, if they do good things, that's great. And once you become an instrumentalist, I think you really have to ask the question of what role do the states play, and is that instrumentally good, and what in the tort system. Congress really falls down, I think, as the being the principal body that we want to decide these issues for several reasons. One is their focus; its focus is just too wide. When it passes the law, it may put in a preemption position; it may not. But once it does that, getting it to come back and do anything is going to take years, if it ever happens at all. It just it acts too episodically. It has too many things to focus on. In fact, Professor Galley, who's here as well, and I wrote an article where we said that I think agencies are, in some sense, more accountable to the public and to politics than Congress, because they act less episodically. I mean, Congress may be accountable when the statute's passed. It may not as well, but even if you believe that, 10 years later, as preferences drift, the statute is nowhere near where the people's values may be, and yet that's what's on the books, and you can't get Congress to change it. You have veto gates and all those other things. So. Of course, we need Congress to be the backstop, the overseer of the agencies. If the agencies act idiosyncratically or crazily or do something that's really out of touch, then Congress has to be able to say, okay, preemption, no preemption allowed, or something like that. But I don't think Congress should be the primary institution that makes a decision. And courts, for all the reasons Peter said, they're not good at making the balance, the trade-off balance generally about whether, not whether there's liability in this case, but whether in fact preemption as a matter of, you know, what is the best, most beneficial thing for society is a good thing. Now here we're not talking about juries and attorneys getting involved, because usually it's a legal issue, but even judges, I think, are not really trained at that, and that's not really their forte. As I said, there are some exceptions. Congress has to have, ultimately does have, and we can't take it away, the power to say, agencies, you cannot or can do this. But now, when it comes to agencies, I would say that agencies should be seen as the principal institution which should be responsible for making preemption decisions. And that has some interesting doctrinal implications. One, I, by the way, I would think that they should do so by rulemaking processes, because I think those are more accountable, deliberate, and agencies tend to take more care and be less influenced. You know, the worst cases would be in enforcement discretion, where you do get a lot of, I think you can claim that they're a capture, at least of individuals. But at the rulemaking level, I think with court oversight and procedures, the agencies do pretty well. So they should be able to do it by rulemaking, and that rulemaking should be subject to the usual rules of judicial review. Explain why you decided that preemption was appropriate or not appropriate in this context, depending on what your rule is. So I would argue that agencies should actually have preemptive authority when they have rulemaking authority. You shouldn't have to have Congress delegate separate preemptive authority. The agency should have it as part of their rulemaking authority. Secondly, some other implications. Courts shouldn't stretch to find evidence that Congress intended it. Well, if you accept my first doctrinal change, then we don't have a need for, and courts shouldn't have to stretch to say, I think Congress intended that this be preempted, when the evidence is very weak on the statutory record that Congress even thought about it, let alone intended anything. Again, if you don't have the agencies to back it up, it may be necessary, because courts can't say, I think it's a good idea. They have to act based on the law. But it's really almost a fiction that you can get out of by having the agency play this role. So if the agency can do that, then you should have the court say, we're not going to stretch to find preemption. Or actually, I think they shouldn't stretch to find savings clauses as well. They should leave it to the agency, unless Congress has clearly said, no, we have to come in here. We think the agency needs to be constrained. This, by the way, would, just to show you how radical it might be, would do away, in my notion, with occupying the field preemption altogether. You don't need it. The agency can say, you know, we have the authority to do it. We can decide in particular cases whether to do it or not. We don't have to say it occupies the whole field or not. So it's a much more fine-grained tool, I think. And finally, I think I would make an exception to say that if there are if there are, if information is developed in the, either through the tort process or just the experience, and it doesn't look like the agency has the motivation or otherwise is going to get back to the issue, and the court can sit there and say, given the information that I have at this time, which may be years after the initial regulatory decision, it is clear that the balance that the regulators and or Congress meant to draw or to create between the various goals of the scheme are going to be undermined. I suppose they could find some sort of conflict regulation there, but it would be much more limited. So the court's role would, so both Congress's and the court's role, in my view, should be much more limited in finding preemption, and we should leave it to the agencies generally to do that, subject to these exceptions that I talked about. I think that's pretty much outlined where I'm going, and it would take too much time to go into the details, so I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
The next speaker is Richard NAGAREDA. I realize I didn't get his fancy title. He's a professor of law at Vanderbilt. Like everyone else here, he has a fancy endowed chair. He's well known as a mass tort scholar. He doesn't teach in torts directly, but he has extensive practical experience with mass torts, and will bring that unique perspective to this issue.
Thank you, Mark, and thank you to the students and to Kathy Sharkey for inviting me to this very interesting discussion. In thinking about the questions of institutional competence that we're focusing on in this panel, I want to talk about the relationship between doctrine and institutional competence, because in thinking about where things have gone in recent years, it strikes me that there's a deep disconnection between two sorts of things. The first is the vocabulary that courts use in preemption cases, particularly in the sorts of cases that Peter Schuck described, these sort of technocratic and very expertise-intensive sort of cases. The second thing consists of what we've learned about how risk regulation actually works, or at least should work, over the past quarter century. And by saying we, I really do mean that on more or less a bipartisan basis, across people like John Graham, the previous head of OIRA, and people like Cass Sunstein, the incoming nominee for the position. In judicial opinions, one sees the main questions about preemption, certainly in briefs as well, set up in recurring sorts of ways. Courts ask whether agency regulation provides a ceiling that tort liability somehow cannot exceed, or a floor that tort might usefully supplement. In addition, courts get all wrapped up in questions about whether there are some sort of conflicting commands being issued by the federal sovereign and the state sovereign, which puts the court in the position of asking, for example, whether some obscure provision of the CFR means that drug labeling could or could not be changed by regulated industry after the drug was allowed to be put on the market by, let's say, the FDA. I don't mean to suggest that these inquiries are useless. It's understandable that they would persist in any system dedicated to the notion of stare decisis, but still, it struck me in reading the recent cases that the notion of ceilings and floors and commands conveys two impressions that should sound rather odd when we actually pull them out and expose them. The first impression is that regulation generally takes the form of relatively simple commands to do or to refrain from doing some sort of specified action. The second impression is that more regulation above a basic floor is generally desirable, or in particular that regulation usually operates in a kind of Pareto optimal way, that it pushes down the risk that we don't like and leaves us basically no worse off in other regards. My suggestion is that this sort of vocabulary embedded in doctrine is increasingly anachronistic, and the confused state that we see in the law of preemption is, I think, a manifestation of that anachronism. We now know a lot more about agency risk regulation, and the prime drivers of that knowledge, I think, are twofold. One is the bipartisan consensus about risk regulation that has emerged in the actual actions of both Democratic and Republican administrations over the past 30 years. The second thing, and this is a little more academic to be sure, is the influence of positive political theory on our thinking about administrative law and the behavior of administrative agencies more generally. What I think is needed is a kind of new preemption vocabulary that better integrates these sorts of developments into doctrine. What I think we need is what one might call a new preemption vocabulary for the cost-benefit state. Now, one thing I want to emphasize at the outset is that this does not proceed from some sort of rosy-eyed view of agencies. In some ways, the more one thinks that agencies are underfunded or uninformed or susceptible to capture, I think the more the approach that I'm about to describe might have something to be said for it. There are three main points about where I think we should be headed. First is that by now there's a broad recognition that risk regulation involves making complex risk-benefit trade-offs, and in particular, risk-risk trade-offs. Risk-risk trade-offs challenge the notion that regulation generally proceeds in a kind of Pareto-optimal manner. Risk and benefits, moreover, can differ for different subpopulations, especially in the pharmaceutical context. This is a point that Richard Epstein underscores in his recent book. So simply asking about ceilings or floors doesn't really capture very well the idea that regulation might seek to foster a particular constellation, a particular package of both risks and benefits. The second point is that a sensible program of risk regulation has a lot more tools at its disposal than just blunt, simplified commands. We've moved quite a bit from 1970s style command and control regulation to a much broader menu available for agencies. We think today about how regulation might, for example, recognize a variety of ways, a menu of ways in which to achieve a desired result or a desired outcome that might be superior to regulation that seeks to prescribe a particular avenue to that result. So notions of performance standards in regulatory policymaking are the manifestation of this idea. So focusing on conflicting commands doesn't especially well capture this development. The third point goes to positive political theory, and that is that positive political theory is not just academic. I think it helps us to see that doctrine is something that is the byproduct of interactions between the relevant institutions and interest groups, and doctrine shapes those interactions. By focusing on things like floors and ceilings and commands, which are, I think, matters largely of characterization, I would submit, and this may be rather controversial, but I would submit the preemption doctrine in recent years has actually unwittingly, unintentionally invited the sort of gamesmanship we've seen in recent years under the previous administration. What I mean by that is that the trick was, in years past, to get the relevant legal framework characterized by the agency as a ceiling or as giving rise to a federal command, but often not to sign on, at least for industry to not sign on, to the kinds of painstaking risk-benefit and risk-risk analysis that we think makes for sensible regulation. Where does that leave us today? The FDA is clearly under new stewardship, but our preemption doctrine is not. My suggestion is that we should craft doctrine to induce and to privilege the sort of enlightened risk regulation that I've described. The question, it seems to me, is not whether regulation creates a ceiling or a floor. The question is twofold. First, whether the agency has actually engaged the particular risk question that the tort plaintiff is now seeking to put before the jury. And second, whether the agency has provided some reasoned explanation for selecting a particular constellation of risks and benefits. So for those who are familiar with the literature, this puts me in line in part with what Kathy Sharkey has suggested in her agency reference view. I think one could, in addition, develop a framework for, let's say, the burden of coming forward on the preemption question with the defendant, let's say, obligated to identify in the agency record where there is actual evidence of this kind of engagement with the risk question that's come up in the tort case. If so, then the plaintiff might be obliged to pinpoint some material change in information that has emerged since the agency action that is alleged to be preemptive. Now, interestingly enough, in terms of the case law, Wyeth versus Levine before the Supreme Court, and the record is not entirely clear, but I think, to my mind, Wyeth may well be a case in which we have neither any real agency engagement with the particular risk in question, nor any change in risk information later on. That is why I suspect Wyeth will be a tough case for the Supreme Court to decide. The key point, though, and the point I would leave you with, remains that it strikes me that the hard work of preemption doctrine is to make sense of where we've come on a bipartisan basis over the last quarter century in terms of thinking about the means at our disposal to deal with complex risk regulation in a complex society. Thanks.
Final speaker is Ben Sapersky, who's a professor of law, again, has a chair at Fordham Law School. Ben is a legal philosopher in addition to an accomplished tort scholar, so he's going to bring that perspective. And Ben first learned torts while studying for his JD degree at this law school, so it's particularly nice to have Ben back here.
Thank you, Mark. It's a real pleasure to be here on this panel with Peter, Richard, and Mark. I think I just should begin by saying you all of you out there should be aware that it truly is a sad state of affairs when Ben Sapersky is the torts guy who's going to represent the sort of progressive pro-plaintiff point of view, which is what I am on this particular panel. I guess in one respect, however, I'm going to articulate a very old-fashioned view, and in that sense, more conservative view. My view is that the institutional competence question is not necessarily nearly as important as many members of this panel think, and that, in fact, we've already moved an extraordinary distance towards the dream position of the defense bar and of pharmaceutical manufacturers, for example, manufacturers of many products. We've already moved an unbelievable distance in their direction if we think that institutional competence is the big question. Okay, so here's how I would look at it. Baseline within tort law, both negligence law, products liability, as you probably all know, the baseline is that regulatory compliance is relevant to the question of whether there was fault, but not at all dispositive. So I could find 100 cases like that that say this from every jurisdiction. It's restatement law. I believe it's in the restatement third, products liability also. Now, Peter and I have discussed his institutional competence concerns about juries versus agencies quite a lot, and I've learned a lot from him on that, and I am quite moved by many of the considerations Peter is articulating. And so it is possible that if I were a state legislator, I would vote for a statute that crafted some kind of careful regulatory compliance defense. So, and that there would be a lot of advantages to having such a statute. I probably wouldn't, I'm just not sure. I probably would for punitive damages, but not for other things. But that's a different question. So here are some of the advantages to having such a statute. First, I feel that from a kind of fairness and equitable point of view, a company like Wyeth has a pretty good argument that it behaved pretty well in that it actually had a warning there. It actually communicated with the FDA about whether maybe it should have some better warning or different warning. They turned them down. I think companies are in a hard spot when they're trying to comply with what the FDA tells them to do. And then they're worried about 50 jurisdictions. You know, what's going to happen at trial in front of a bunch of jurors? So there's sort of a fairness argument, making life easier and more manageable, and also less costly for manufacturers who have to hire lawyers to give them advice on various things. Just have a regulatory compliance defense in there. I know deal with that conflict they face of trying to accommodate both things. Also, we would probably have less lower litigation costs and liability costs. We'd have fewer lawsuits in our state if we had a regulatory compliance defense, and that would inure to the benefit of consumers in many ways, undoubtedly. That's another good reason. We'd probably, as Peter suggests, have fewer mistakes. In other words, we'd have fewer verdicts in which a company is held liable for having put out an unsafe product in light of the failure to include adequate warnings if the FDA compliance were defense. And of course, many jurisdictions do have statutory defenses now like this, because I think jurors make mistakes after the fact. Also, I think maybe I would, if I were a legislator, think maybe it's a good idea for our state to be part of a movement. There are, let's say, 10 other states that have some form of regulatory compliance defense, because after all, it is pretty bizarre that we don't have a national scheme of products liability law, since it's a national activity. There are some disadvantages, too. Injured people won't be getting compensation. A lot of them need it. So insofar as the tort system makes up for various gaps that we have in providing compensation to people in need, that function would be lost. I think there are cases where juries get the right answer and the FDA got the wrong answer. I don't think Peter, for example, would deny that this could happen. The competence argument is an argument over the broad picture, but it doesn't mean that there are not true positives in the tort system. And these are cases where defendants should be held responsible for what they've done, or at least my state tort law, I would think if I was a legislator, is committed to that idea, and I don't see why I should be sort of getting rid of some part of responsibility law for people who have caused some injury that they're responsible. We'd be getting rid of some of those. I also think, as Mark nicely explained, there may be some political reasons. There's a variety of more complicated institutional reasons why we might think that it's valuable to have tort law, products liability law, operating in the states as a kind of backstop for regulatory failure, which occurs sometimes in to massive degrees, as in the Vioxx case, truly massive degrees, and it doesn't just occur once every 25 years, it occurs a fair amount. And finally, there is this norm that state tort law has that actually people are required to do more than comply with regulations. They're required to act as the reasonably prudent person would, to think through various things, to go beyond, and I'd be giving up on that. So there's lots of pros and cons to a regulatory compliance defense. That's a decision for a state legislature to make in the first case. Now we have an interesting institutional competency argument. Could Congress make the decision for everybody? Did they just make it? I think the answer as a constitutional matter is almost certainly yes, they could. What if I were in Congress? Would I vote for this or not? There's pros and cons. I won't rattle them off, but there are a number of things for and against. That's not the preemption question we're dealing with in any of these cases that people are interested in. Preemption question we're dealing with is, what should a court do? Now, it seems to me, if Congress hasn't done it, and we're talking about states that, by definition, haven't voted on a regulatory compliance defense, I just don't see the argument that this one particular advantage of agencies over juries, which is a very important one, but just one piece of the whole picture, if you were looking in a completely different political context, which is that of a state legislature voting on a regulatory compliance defense, why this should somehow be particularly probative of what a court is doing in a preemption case, I don't understand that. And I don't think it is a bearing. It's a leapfrog based on the idea that these other actors haven't acted and were faced with all the disadvantages that go along with not actually having a regulatory compliance defense in the states or in Congress. Now, there's a related, there's a second piece, there's actually a second and third, but I doubt I'll get to the third. The second question I want to ask is, what should we do about basically implied preemption rather than some broad, either technically field preemption or some sort of broader sweep on statutes in implied preemption cases that would effectively give you some chunk of field preemption, which is roughly speaking what I was alluding to before. What if we're dealing with a smaller, narrower conflict, impossibility preemption case? And here, I think what Richard said about commands is very, very interesting, but I would flip it around entirely. So my view is that it's the defendants who are bringing in the command language here. And the reality is, if they manage to succeed on the command language, because you need the command, it's just having two different answers from juries and agencies on the answer to a question isn't going to give you what you need in impossibility conflict preemption. You need two commands that conflict. It's the defendants brought them. So if the defendants win on the command language, and then we start to see the reality of the regulatory world is something much softer that would appropriately use a different language. We're talking about taking, breathing the life of Geyer into what would have been decided on the basis of a much narrower command picture, and we're going to be dealing with a huge amount of preemption in front of us if we do that. So the last thing I want to say is, it seems to me that the court has moved far too fast on the idea that state tort law contains requirements. And you're looking at someone who has made a huge amount of his career, such as it is, trying to argue that a Calabresian type of, the distortion of a Calabresian view into a kind of pricing view in tort law is wrong, and we need to think of tort law as more about rules of conduct. With that said, the idea of doing that in products liability law, in particular failure to warn cases where we have jury verdicts, and reading particular jury verdicts as somehow pronouncements of a state judiciary that thou shalt not do this in a way that conflict with something that a federal agency had said is a vast overreading of the content of what products liability law does. The premise that the court has taken, or that the court would take were it to decide Wyeth the way Wyeth would like, the premise that state products liability law verdicts count as commands from a state sovereign on how one is to behave with regard to this particular product, it seems to me completely mistaken. So whether you go on a very broad view or you go on an impossibility view, it seems to me that people are reading far too many assumptions into the framework to get at the institutional competency question as the key question. Thanks.
So before opening it up, I just want to circle back to my question that I started off with. So I gather then that the primary relevance on most of the views here to the institutional competence question is, as has been articulated here, is really relevant to the regulatory compliance defense issue. So that insofar as you think administrators have a comparative advantage in this field, then the appropriate legal response is to adopt a regulatory compliance defense as a matter of tort law. But if we're thinking about statutory interpretation and preemption, it's not clear, outside of Mark Seidenfeld's view here, as to the relevance of the competence issue. And Mark's take is interesting, but you know, it does raise questions about what the enabling statute allows the agency to do. So for example, you could imagine the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration deciding that the market works really well and that we don't need any regulation whatsoever. And so they issue a blanket preemption of all state tort law claims involving automobile safety. So there's not going to be any product suits moving forward alleging defective design and so on of automobiles. And we're not going to regulate it either because we think the market works great. Now, on your view, as you articulated it anyway, I think that would work for preemption purposes, field preemption here. And it's not clear to me that that would be defensible when you formulate it in those terms. And then to leave it again with everybody else on the panel, is it true that what we're largely talking about here is regulatory compliance and not preemption? So we do that, and then we'll open it up to the group after that.
Do I get a chance to respond?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, no, you can all answer, and then we'll field questions from the group.
Well, I mean, yes. In terms of the bounds of what would be allowed, NHTSA could certainly do that and not be beyond its authority. It would have to convince a court that the market really does work well, and that it had, or at least it had, pretty good support for that. I don't know enough about NHTSA either, but you know, for those of us who are familiar with the way courts review agencies, there is some constraint on just what the agency can say and do, and the information it marshals. At the very least, if it did make that claim and then had to defend it in court, that would bring the matter, would escalate the matter to a point where it probably wouldn't get away with it, and if it did, it would probably be something that the interest groups would bring to Congress with a lot more force, saying, look what those crazy people at NHTSA did. And so there are checks on that, and I didn't get to talk about the importance of the checks and how they work and what I think, but remember, it would have to be done by a notice and comment rulemaking with participation. You have, even within NHTSA, you have different interest groups represented by the different professions from the inside. I guess the answer is, yeah, you can come up with hypotheticals of, is this allowed, but would it ever really happen, and if it would happen, would the reviewing court or Congress let it stand? I think the answer is probably no. On all those counts.
I had a thought about this question of whether the interaction between federal agency action or federal agency regulation and state tort litigation ought to be cast as a federal law question, or whether it's a state law question, which is, as I understand, Marcus, the question you're putting to us. It occurs to me that, and this is perhaps a different way in which I might have framed my presentation, is that at least on the account that I was describing, there's something, I think, at the core of preemption that is rather similar to what we in litigation would call issue preclusion. That is, has this issue been sort of actually determined and in some sort of process that we have confidence in previously, such that it ought not to be revisited? If one casts preemption in those regards, and I think preclusion is not a perfect fit, it is not obvious that the preclusive effect of the first determination is something that is simply a matter for the second institution or the second sovereign to evaluate as it pleases. So I guess I would push back a little bit against the notion that this is simply a matter of regulatory compliance defense design.
I'm basically in agreement with Richard's position. We ought to address this as a policy question, a question of legal design. How do we want the system to be organized? What values and institutions do we want to be brought to bear on decisions of this technocratic character? And I think that allowing each state to decide for itself how this question ought to be resolved is not a sound way to run a regulatory railroad. It's introducing diversity in precisely the area that we should not want diversity. Once we've made the decision, as I have tried to justify, that this is a kind of decision making that ought to be lodged in the regulatory agencies, unless Congress, of course, provides otherwise.
I wanted to respond to both what Richard and Peter said. So I think the point about preclusion is very interesting, but there would, even if you took that analogy to be apt, there would still be a question about who decides whether the issues are really the same issues. And it seems to me quite clear that the state's determinations about the conditions under which it wants one person to be able to sue another for compensation, the decision about the relationship between that and federal regulation in the first instance is the state's to make. So the question of what is the nexus between these two in the first instance is the state's. And I would add one other point, which just provocatively pushes on Mark's excellent title. I mean, the problem with who decides is that that's actually not too hard a question. The answer to the question is the states decide under our constitutional system as we now understand it, given where the federal statutes are on these issues, and given the constitutional understanding of the role of tort law in the constitutional system. Right now, the state decides. There are various moves that people could make that would dislodge that, but just hammering at the Supreme Court for two or three decades about how there's too much tort liability isn't a sufficient basis for unsettling this settled question.
Okay, we'll open it up, and since everybody doesn't know everybody else here, if you could introduce yourself. I think we all know you, Judge Calabresi, so you don't need to.
Sure. I've been listening with wonder at this excellent panel, really with wonder, because there are all sorts of things it seems to take for granted that I don't take for granted. I don't believe there is any evidence whatever that regulation by experts has made a better set of decisions with respect to safety and accidents than the highly flawed tort system that we have. Peter says so, but where's the evidence? For years, we've gone along with this. Maybe things have changed. Old Judge Werner, in holding workers' compensation unconstitutional, but allowing regulation to do the same thing, made exactly the same assumptions. He got laughed out 100 and some years ago. It may be, he may have been right. He may have been right. But we don't have any evidence of it. A tort system, which is not our tort system, but which was a system that said the amount that people have to pay depends on the accidents that they happen to have. The tort pricing system, which Ben says is not part of it, but say a New Zealand one, would be another way of doing it. I'm not saying it necessarily is better, but even aside from whether juries are good or not, that is worth thinking about because there's no evidence to the contrary at all. The compensation might be another matter. The fairness to Wyeth, what is unfair? Punitive damages, blame, all sorts of things that are unfair. But what is unfair about an entrepreneur who takes a risk which is uninsurable and loses? Traditionally, in an enterprise system, such an entrepreneur goes broke. If they take the risk and they win, they make pots of money. That's what profit is, and profit is blessed, as Frank Knight and my great uncle said. It is exactly that, the return for taking an uninsured risk. But if you do bad, it's not unfair for you to go broke. There's nothing strange. Now, the system we have today adds all sorts of unnecessary costs on it, but that doesn't mean that going to regulation is better. And finally, as to Mark, I could go on, obviously, for a longer time, but as to Mark and letting the regulatory agencies decide, that sounds good, but here I'm going to sound like a judge for the first time. My own experience is with Chevron deference, is that it tends to be a disaster. And it tends to be a disaster precisely because the less good the agency is, the more aggressive it is on protecting its own power, authority, and claiming more. The BIA, just look at it. Terrible agency and is asserting power all over the place. Now, maybe that can be controlled, but courts are not as good as I think you think we are once we get into a notion of saying let the agency decide for itself. I don't like any of the others, I mean, the decision makers. I thought I said that, but I'm afraid that I would be skeptical of that.
One-on-ones. So I think we'll have Richard Epstein here. He's jumping out of his chair, which is something that's going to be happening with increased frequency over the next few years here at NYU.
No, it's an answer to Guido. There is evidence. I mean, that's the problem. There's too much of it. One piece of evidence is when you find merchants exiting the field by virtue of the fact that they can't play under the rules, the question you're asking, is it entrepreneurial or not? And it is entrepreneurial if they could limit their risk by contract. But remember, this entire game starts on the assumption that you cannot play contractual limitations, so you're not an ordinary person. The major form of self-defense that you have is stripped from you, and the question is what sort of backup system is going on? And to say that Wyeth is taking a risk, it's taking a risk of the incompetence of downstream users of its own products, given the fact that it is warned against the very things that have been done, this doesn't strike me as at all sensible. That's the first point. And the second point about evidence on this, it's not only theoretical, it's practical, is it's one thing to talk about a judgment. It's another thing to talk about the sum of judgments. And if you take, say, the crashworthiness doctrines as they emerge through the cases, when there's no preemption, of course, and you put them all together, this was once done by a fellow named Charlie Babcock at General Motors. He built the car that met every design standard in every tort case that they had lost. The thing gained 1,000 pounds. It cost $10,000 more and it didn't move. But other than that, it was a great car. And so, I mean, you cannot, in effect, in this case, and I think everybody in the industry realizes this, you can't rely on ex post judgments about how one portion of a system ought to be made unless the whole things are done. And I think the argument in favor of agency review in this case is that this gives you a level of consistency on the point, so that the ex-ante perspective means that you can't overrate one as against the other, whereas the ex-post system gives everybody a libertine holiday because you can always change one part of the situation while leaving everything else untouched. So I think that you guys are in very sound shape, and we have to rein in the bench, rein in the agencies, and return to contracting will be a lot better.
So I just wanted to maybe add two things along the same line of inquiry. So the first, I think I agree with Guido and disagree with Richard with respect to the empirical evidence, the dearth of real empirical evidence. And I think part of it is we try to think about these things in very ideologically, rhetorically charged circumstances, like the ones that present themselves in the cases today about medical devices. And we get anecdotes of horror of sort of injured people on one side and then horror of people drastically leaving the market. But they're anecdotes. And as far as I'm aware, and this came about because I'm teaching a seminar on tort versus regulation, Jerry Mishaw has tried to unearth a historical example with steamboat regulation. And it's a really interesting example, except he seems to think that he's uncovered evidence that indisputably supports regulation over tort liability in that context. But there's some underlying econometric studies that actually show that it's a really difficult question to try to measure because there are all sorts of other information-producing measures, like the government was commissioning studies on why were these steamboats blowing up in the way that they were, et cetera, et cetera. And I think it's actually a really difficult question, particularly because most of the instances we would try to examine empirically have a combination right now of both tort and regulation. But I mean, I think if people could think creatively about studies they might do to test that question, it would be really interesting. On the second point about judicial review of agencies, and this is really a question mostly for Mark, Richard, and Peter, but Ben, if he wants to put on his hat of sort of going so far as to credit, we want to get some kind of participation by agencies, almost everyone, it seems to me, would want to start thinking about a judicial review. And Mark, you've written about this as well. I wonder how each of you responds to the growing now literature that Cass Sunstein still, in his academic hat, and Tom Miles are producing, showing the politicization of the court review of agencies, both using Chevron or arbitration arbitrary and capriciousness, and whether that, if we think politicization of agencies and politicization of the judiciary is going on, sort of where that leaves us in this comparative discussion.
I want to address Guido's point, which Kathy, I think, interestingly complexified. Guido asks, where's the evidence? Well, as Kathy suggested, these judgments are very, very difficult to make for a bunch of methodological reasons. But we do have some evidence that suggests that we are better advised to discuss, not to answer the question that Guido raised, but actually to answer the question on the basis of institutional competence comparisons. So, for example, in the Vioxx case, which is trotted out as a classic example of agency failure. Well, if you look at the tort, if you look at the verdicts reached by juries in tort cases, the vast majority of them found that Vioxx was okay. Some didn't. That's part of the problem. So I don't think we're going to answer the question that Guido asks methodology by which we can determine who made the right decision in these extraordinarily complex cases. The way we can go about it is to decide over the full range of cases, given what we know about institutions and how they go about acquiring information, analyzing information, correcting errors, and so on and so forth, which of them is better equipped to make these kinds of decisions? If we focus, as Guido would have us focus, on evidence that a particular decision was right or wrong, I think we're going to end up with no answers at all. So we have to do it on the basis of institutional characteristics, as imperfect as that analytical approach will inevitably be.
Couple of things. One, I'm not an expert on the empirical evidence. I bet if you looked hard enough, you could find some. The difficulty is that you're comparing. It's easy to find evidence where the agency system quote didn't work and the tort system did, because the product's on the market, and then it creates an injury. But what you'd have to know to see whether the tort system creates harms is what product isn't on the market because of the risk and the concern about liability, and what is the effect of not having that product on the market. It's very, very hard to know that, because how are you going to get data about the products that aren't on the market? I suppose you could try to do surveys and get anecdotal data, but it's very, very difficult to get that kind of information. And yet you hear stories, and, you know, I don't know I'm not an expert on FDA, but I would, you know, I've heard, I don't know if this had, whether tort liability had anything to do with it, but the flu vaccine, for example, was an example where they said it's underproduced because you have these, you know, huge benefits that aren't covered by the market. There are other examples, I'm sure, where there are things where you're going to lose some benefits, and it's hard to get. And finally, I just want to say, I understand that you say that these agencies that exert all this power are the ones who do the worst job. First of all, you know, I'm not talking about the Chevron doctrine, which basically defers to the agency. I'm talking about arbitrary and capricious review after a rulemaking. Now, I think a lot of the times the cases you're talking about, I don't know, does the BIA act by rulemaking, or is it basically making decisions of who to give money to on individual cases where they don't have a record and it's very difficult? My experience seems to indicate that it's the judges do a much better job when they have a full rulemaking record at telling the agency when they miss things. And even if the judge gets it wrong and the agency, it elevates it to a point where it becomes politically salient.
Hi. I was sort of, can you hear me? Disappointed at how little the panel mentioned compensation. I think a couple of you didn't mention compensation at all, but tort system does have a regulatory effect. It creates regulatory incentives, but the purpose of it is to provide compensation. And a system under which the agency gets to decide whether or not tort law can go forward does nothing for people who will be injured anyway. Even when the agency was at its best, and I think it's been some time since it's been at its best, people still got injured, and so there will still be costs. The question that tort law answers is, who bears the cost in any individual case? Is it the manufacturer or the injured patient or injured victim? The costs don't go away just because tort law goes away. Someone is still going to pay. It's either going to be the patient, or in many cases, it's going to be society. In the realm of FDA, for example, the majority of people who take prescription drugs are elderly, and they're on Medicare, and so we're all going to help pay. So, you know, as between Wyeth or Medtronic or society as a whole, you have to think about who should be paying for the injury that was caused. And as for the regulatory compliance defense, of course, every single state has a regulatory compliance defense, but almost everyone says that compliance is a defense, not a get-out-of-jail-free card. And then the question is, would a reasonable manufacturer have done more? And I think that's a really important element. And NHTSA provides a good example. NHTSA actually, over the past 3.5 years, has issued any number of rulemakings where the notice in the Federal Register says that this rule does preempt tort claims. In most cases, there's about 2 sentences to justify it. In one case, they actually put it in the final rule, in the regulation itself. So if you look in the CFR, it says you can't bring a tort suit. But NHTSA is the perfect example of an agency that shouldn't be doing that, because, for instance, there's a roof crush rule about how strong the roof of your vehicle has to be. It's 30 years old. They've been redoing that rulemaking now for about 5 years, and then they probably won't do it for another 30 years. So what about somebody who gets injured 5 years after the rule comes out? For NHTSA to say next week this rule is preemptive when the rule is going to exist for 30 years, to me that doesn't make sense. A reasonable manufacturer 5 years from now will have new technologies available, and it would be a reasonable question to ask, would a reasonable manufacturer have done more at that time? And last, I just want to respond briefly to Professor Epstein. Wyeth shouldn't win on preemption because, in your view or in the justice's view, Diana has a weak case on the merits. Preemption isn't a case-by-case thing. It's a legal defense, so that Regal may have lost because we had a weak case there, but that also applies to the cases that were just dismissed in Minnesota, hundreds of cases in an MDL, where Medtronic knew the product was defective, and that is undisputed. It knew the product was defective. It got a better product approved, but continued to sell the bad one that killed people because they wanted to clear their inventory. And those cases are now preempted too. So preemption can't turn on the facts of the one case before the court. I was hoping to end on the question, but I couldn't really do it.
I had a thought on the compensation point, right? At one level, it's sort of indisputable. And at another level, I think it sort of suppresses what is a real concern here. The level on which it's indisputable is that does tort litigation have as one of its sort of outputs or consequences compensation? And that's clearly true. But either on a more economically oriented or Calabresian type of account of tort, or the kind of corrective justice or civil recourse type of notion that Ben Zapersky and others have developed, it's not just a sort of compensation regime, it's a compensation regime for wrongs. Right? It's not New Zealand, it's not the 9/11 fund, it's not workers' compensation. And the core concern here in the preemption context is, has there been a wrong, whether defined in terms of risk utility or in some other notion? And that's where the idea that, where the concern arises, where some supposedly superior sovereign in the constitutional sense has made a determination along those lines. It seems to me it's a very serious question over whether a, in some ways, subordinate sovereign should be in the position of defining wrongs differently. And so I think saying that there's a compensatory consequence of tort law doesn't really focus on where the real conflict is, or at least the potential for conflict is.
Actually, also on that, because it's important, because the compensation issue is raised frequently. these cases typically are products liability cases. And if you look at the distributional consequences, something that Guido has long emphasized, in products cases, you understand that by and large, the right holder, the consumers in these cases, unlike a stranger case, they've got a contractual relationship. And so the costs of compensation are built into the product price and are ultimately borne by right holders. So you've got a situation in which the right holder benefits from the safety, but is also burdened by both the safety obligations and the compensatory obligations that tort law imposes on the manufacturers. And so you're forcing consumers to pay for this compensation. And so in this context, unlike other tort contexts, to think about this really in insurance terms is completely defensible, whether you're an economist or a philosopher, fairness-based, because of the distributional aspects of this particular set of relationships. And so in those contexts, to say that you want to purchase your insurance through the tort system, where you have to get your insurance payment by hiring a contingency fee lawyer, is extraordinarily expensive. And so this is where Peter's earlier point, if we care about compensation, and surely we ought to care about compensation, then you're going to think about insurance systems which are able to deliver the money at much lower cost, so that what a consumer wants by way of compensation is to induce the manufacturer to supply safer products. That's the instrumental objective of compensation within a products case. As meritorious as compensation is otherwise writ large, the distributional features of compensation in a product suit is just to induce safety. It's not to provide a check for injured people.
Mark, could I respond? I think one of the reasons preemption in products liability has become as powerful as it has is that many tort scholars and lawyers and judges perceive correctly, in my view, that products liability law, while it flirted for a long time with genuine strict liability, has moved in a more fault-ish direction. And to this extent, I agree with Richard. But I think that can be seriously overstated. That is, I think there's a real blend in any jurisdiction today in their, what they typically still call their strict products liability law. There's a real blend. Even in the failure to warn cases, there's a real blend. For example, it's an open question whether it's foresight or hindsight. And even if they say, well, we're into foresight now, they don't always remain true to the idea of accepting a foresight standard. And they sometimes don't remain true to that deliberately. That is, there are a variety of kinds of mixes. And this is true of torts generally, and of the notion of wrongs, that just because it's a notion of wrongs, it doesn't mean the notion of wrongs lacks strict liability edges. So, for example, trespass to property is clearly a wrong. We understand how that's an invasion of a right, but it has strict liability edges. Warranty, which in some sense is at the root of products liability, is breach of warranty is a wrong, but it has strict liability edges. And jurisdictions push forward, in my view, with their failure to warn products liability law in a manner that preserves at least some strict liability edges. And that's what's going on when you have cases in which there's FDA compliance, but there's still liability. To that extent, it feels strict liability-ish, and they've done it because they want it, and they want it in part for these compensation-based reasons.
I'm a little surprised by how willing most of the panel is, along with my college classmate on the right here, to trash the general notions of the beneficial effects of a negligence standard in terms of discouraging people from making decisions that will be harmful to other people down the line. And what a preemption does this, and I think Allison's comment about the effect of preempting a medical device litigation on clearly not very close risk benefit, oh my goodness, it's one risk against another, you know, just shipping out the
the trash. I don't know what the preemption situation would be with that peanut manufacturer that's shipping out material with salmonella in it. But you have, I mean, the idea that we're going to abandon this general principle that's otherwise, you know, permeating this basic principle in our law, which is that everyone needs to think about how their conduct is going to affect people going forward, and if the conduct is unreasonable, they have to either not do it or pay the piper when the damages occur. And I, you know, so that when Judge Calabresi talked about the costs here, major thing we don't know is how many costs are being saved by having, when you do have an effective, unpreempted tort system, how many really atrocious pieces of behavior don't go forward. And, you know, I mean, maybe we can look, and maybe the real test would be now that maybe we do have some potential empirical evidence. We've seen a trashing of the tort system, and the question is, has there been an increase in irresponsible behavior? I have nothing but the anecdotes of reading the newspapers for the last few months to suggest how that might come out.
I'm George Kunk, and I was on the brief in the only comprehensive appellate opinion in Vioxx case. And that's McDarby versus Merck, in which the verdict in favor of the plaintiff was upheld. There was a mixed result of the bellwether trials in the Vioxx cases. Generally, the company was found to have behaved badly, and in more cases than not, the defense was successful on the issue of causal relationship. In writing the statement of facts in that brief, which you can read in McDarby versus Merck, because the court had to answer the question whether there was a state of facts that the jury could have accepted that supported liability. What I found in reviewing the record is that there really were no technocratic decisions to be made by the jury in the course of that trial. The question was, how did Merck behave given the evidence? There was no command by the FDA. There was defiance by Merck over an extended period of time of the FDA review, single FDA review officers urging that more study be done, directly addressed to the cardiac question. The most dramatic moments were things like emails that said things like, their proposal that we have a cardiac warning is ugly cubed, they're bastards and we will fight them. And they did, and the FDA was of the view at that time that it didn't have the authority to command them, and so they acquiesced in a compromise. Now, perhaps the 2007 amendments to the Food and Drug Act will improve the situation. If so, there will be fewer people injured and there will be fewer tort claims, and that's a good thing. But the heart of it is that Merck had reason to believe from the early stages of development that there were cardiac risks in that medicine. They never established the superiority of that medicine over anything other than placebo. They turned it into the best-selling medication, anti-inflammatory medication. They went from zero to $2 billion in 18 months and spent the next 24 months fighting to keep it on the market. And the question that the jury was asked had nothing to do with these technical questions. Everybody agreed the product had been withdrawn from the market, that it was dangerous, that it caused heart attacks, and that the only question was how much of a dose did you need to get sick. So the only question was, what do you make of Merck's behavior? Merck's defense wasn't a technocratic defense. Their defense was, we were very sincere. We believed in our drug. We gave it to our families. We took it ourselves. And we were in a learning curve. We saw contrary evidence, and there were judgments to be made about what it meant, and we made our judgments, and eventually we made the prudential judgment to withdraw the product, but we weren't negligent. We were quite sincere and in good faith about it. Some juries accepted that and some did not, but the question at the heart of the case was that question of the standard of human conduct, not the technocratic questions.
Excellent. We're running out of time, but since we have a lot of students here, you should understand it's always important to give the judge the last word. So let's.
I just wondered when I heard the distinguished commissioners on the panel, how much of what they said would apply every bit as much to a decision of whether somebody should go into the business of making shoes. Because of course, if you go into the business of making shoes, and a lot of people who don't know very much choose not to buy it, and you go broke, you lose a huge amount of money. So you may not go into the business of making shoes. But some highly technical experts can say it's a good thing to go into the business of making shoes. Therefore, we will give you, regulated industry, a certificate of necessity, let you into it, and keep you from any liability, from any losses, if we turned out to be wrong. That is what regulation does. Sometimes it does it better than this other system. Of course, if we could do it all by contract in the wonderful world of Richie Epstein, that would be best. There's no question about it. That's no question about it. The question is, does the society, for other reasons, think that that contractual decision is not sufficiently knowledgeable? That's another issue. And I may be much more with Richie than many others are on that, but sometimes the society is not. But the notion that somehow, because only regulators can take into account the risk of not doing it, of not making shoes, we should become a regulatory system, is something which at least traditionally a free enterprise society has rejected. And I have yet to see evidence, rather than experts talking about their capacity as experts to decide, that is convincing the other way. I'm not saying that there's evidence that the free enterprise system is a good one. I'm just saying there ain't much evidence yet the other way.